short time. It's the 31st of May, 2020, and this is Trading Zones. Now, if we take a peek at the futures, it was an interesting week. And, you know, there's a lot of news around us opening back up and different legislation that may be passing through Congress. But what's important? The technicals. So if we take a peek at the technicals, what we see is for this week, what could the futures not do? Well, we couldn't see any bearish advancement below 29.94, which is right here, this line here. And we could not see any bullish advancement above 30.64.75, this line right here. So as we go into this upcoming week, yes, we saw some strength headed into the close. But what I'm watching for is, do we break above 30.64? And if we hold this, are we going to leg up to 31.18? And so that's what I'll be watching going into next week. And if we can't, if we hit our head again on the 30.64, on the retrace, do we catch a bid at 30.28 or at 29.94? And this is on the 4-hour chart. So if you're watching this on a 4-hour chart, you see nothing but these lower wicks. Couldn't get any bearish advancement. And what do I mean by bearish advancement? Okay. So let's find something. Okay. So bearish advancement would mean that we rejected here and we pulled back. And you can see this is an area that kind of held a little bit for a few days. We got to that area. See this rejection here? And then bearish advancement, bearish candles to the downside. That's what I mean by bearish advancement. As you break a level, the selling doesn't stop. Bullish advancement, as you break a level, push here, rejected on this test, bullish advancement to the upside. So that's what I want to see for next week. So to the upside, we're watching to see if we break 30.64.75. Above that, we've got 31.18. Above that, 31.56, 31.80, 32.21, 32.59. To the downside, if we are unable to break 30.64, watch for a back test of 30.28.50, 29.94, 29.71, and actually 29.70, 29.51, 29.45, and the 29.38. But I would watch to see if we see any bearish advancement below this 29.94. Even on this pullback, you see this 29.60.70 area. I won't say 69, but this 29.70 area. You see the almost like a plateau here when you look at these candles through here on the 4-hour. We pull back roughly to that area and caught a bid. So the buyers were like, hey, we're stepping in here, and they pushed us back up on this flare down. So you want to watch for things like that. You want to see if the sellers step in at 30.64 or if we gap up through that area, and then you see the bullish candles pushing us to the upside. That's what you want to see when you see these areas that have been contention areas or rejection or reversal areas. You want to see gap throughs and strong push throughs and then bullish or bearish candlestick formations below if you're looking for bearish to the downside, or bullish above if you're looking for a push to the upside. That's what I'll be watching for on the futures. So on the Russ, it's like a little bit different setup. So we did pull back after grinding up here on the 4-hour against the 14.53. But unlike the MES, we didn't push right back to that level, which tells us that the Russ is a little bit weaker, right? So we did see that bullish end to the week, but we really need to get above this 1416 to even make an attempt at the 1453. So I'll be watching for a potential, right? If you're bullish, what you want to see. So let's look at this. So look at this pullback. So this is the area that we have marked on our chart, right in the 1370s, right? Because we saw when we went here, went sideways a little bit, then we sold bearish candlestick formations from this area. The buyers could not push us up. Sellers took control. So here, we bought back up above this area, right? Right around these 1357s to 1373-ish, right? Bought back above this area. So if you look at the same place on the chart here, right? 1369-ish, 1373-ish. When we dropped into this area, the buyers recognized that. They stepped in. Previous supply becomes demand, and we pop. Does it happen all the time? Nope, it does not happen all the time. But it happened here. And so this is something that you'd keep an eye on if you're trading this, to see when you drop into it. Would you just automatically say, I'm in at a specific number? No, you want a sort of a zone. So you'd probably carry that zone down into the 1350s if you got into this. Like this area here, you may want a deeper, a stronger dip. But once we pulled here, there's a buy up. And you don't necessarily have to buy this dip. What you, if you're bullish and you want to be patient, what you really want to see, you do want to see the buying here, but you wanted them to pop this top at 1453, and you want bullish candlestick formations that drive us into the 1516s. That's what you want to see if you're bullish on this. So above the 1406 area where we closed, we're looking for 1416s, 1453, 1516s, 1560. To the downside, you want to break at this plateau. Not only do you want us to break through the 1370s, you want to break up to 1350s and continue selling down into the 1290s and potentially the 1252s. Amazon had a interesting week, and we see this longer term trend line that we drew here that we kind of pulled back below, and you see a little bit of selling came in. And what you kind of thought it was, or, you know, what we discussed in a few different places was this potentially sector rotation out of the tickers that benefited greatly from the quarantine? Yes, maybe it was. No, maybe it wasn't. But what we saw was potentially a liquidation event, because we pulled down, buyers stepped in, and we pushed right back up. So we'll see if we can continue to the upside through the 2450s, 2470s, and push back through all-time highs, or if we find sellers here in this area up into the 24, between the 2450s and 2470s, if we find sellers and we head back to the downside. So this will be interesting to see if, as the economy opens back up, if the benefits and gains that Amazon received from being so strong online, if they continue to hold those heading into the summer. So we'll see how that works out for Amazon. But we could see the buyers did step in after this nice sell and pull back here. The buyers did step in, and they are trying to push us back to the upside. We'll see how that works. But remember, we are headed into the summer, but this will probably be the most unique summer we've ever had. Next up is Netflix. And if you're looking at Netflix, what we were thinking and what we mentioned in our last few videos was that would Netflix be able to hold these gains with the end of the stay-at-home order, right? In a lot of states, they're opening back up. People are getting back out into the economy. And the thought was that would Netflix's numbers be any higher than it was when they, you know, in essence had a captive audience, right? And so what we expected was there to be sort of a downtrend or a strong dip as the stay-at-home order or orders ended and people began to get back outside. So Netflix did pull back. And where did we see the buyers? We thought that we would see a drop into this area here, which was a previous top-ish area that we back-tested here, pulled back here, tested, springboard, kept going to the upside. And it would have been great if we pulled back into that here, but the buyer stepped in above that, and we pulled back a little bit to the upside. Now, if you look at almost the entire week, there was no bullish advancement above the 418.97 area. So even though we're riding this orange line here at the 200, it's not really a sign of any strength because we saw no bullish advancement from the sell, back test, 418s, dip down here, bought back up, no bullish advancement to the upside. So keep your eye on Netflix to see if the buyers can get us above this 418, 419-ish area. It was like the tops was around 422, but they really couldn't get us any bullish advancement continuation to the upside here on Netflix. So we'll see how that plays out next week. But to the upside, we have 431, 439, 447. To the downside, below the 418s, we've got 410, 405. And if the 390s go, watch the 384s. That was an area that was a strong supply area for well over a year. And so if buyers don't step in there and we roll through there, it could get interesting. But these areas should be pretty strong as far as buyers stepping in, as far as demand for Netflix. If we sell through those hard and the volume increases, that's a sign that the buying and the run may be over for a little bit on Netflix specifically. We'll see. On NVIDIA, what we see here, if you're looking at the 4-hour, is a dip into structure. And this is pre-market stuff, right? So it's not something that you can really, in essence, be in. Let's check the lower time frame real quick. Just look at the 5-minute. So, okay. Maybe. Let me not, because I don't want to throw anybody off. That's what ends up happening. But it looks like intraday you would have had an opportunity to catch this dip into this structure here. And then ride it back up. That's what it looks like on the lower time frame. But right now we push back through these bottoms. So we have to see if we can get back through the 363s. And if we're going to make new all-time highs this upcoming week. But I'll be watching to see if we hold above 351s. If not, watch the 339s, 325s, 317s. We did see buyers in this area on the last pull. So if we pull into the 320s, I would watch to see if we hold that or if we roll through that and if we move lower. So that could be interesting on NVIDIA. On Facebook, we've had a nice run, but there was a nice pullback this week on Facebook. And it kind of looks like it's consolidating above the 222 area. So what do we want to see? On Facebook, you want to see, do we see bearish advancement below the 222s? And do we sell? And do buyers step in at any of these areas, the 219s, the 218s, the 214s, the 212s? For me personally, just looking at candle structure, I would look for buyers right around the 214s if we do sell, the 214s, the 212s. as long as we stay above the 210s, I would still remain bullish on Facebook. If I'm bearish, I just want this area here to just go away, and I want us to sell down into the 214s. If I'm bullish, I want us to push above the 228, and I want bullish candlestick formations that squeeze us up into the 236s and higher on Facebook. And this is kind of an interesting week, just to make a note that the president did, I believe he did sign the executive order, or he threatened to. I believe he did sign it, though, that really challenges the autonomy of online platforms and their ability to regulate speech and what people post on their platforms. So that basically opens them up to potential litigation. So that could be interesting, and a reason why Twitter sold this past week. So it's going to be interesting to see how that resolves itself. Taking a peek at Apple appears to just be consolidating, and we'll see if we get an explosion as these different economies, you know, open up, and people really get back out there, or if people get back out there heavily. We'll see if Apple begins to grind back to the upside, or if the opening up doesn't really lead to sales. So we'll see. But what we have here on Apple, these upper areas here, this 328s. So when we push into the upper 320s, the air has been thin, and we've found sellers. So we'll see if we hold above these 318s. But the area that I watch on Apple is we're above the 308s, and that's a strong area that we want to see almost a swing door. As long as we stay above this 308 to 304 area, I think we're bullish. If we get below that, then we have to watch to see if we see some selling. So that's what my view on Apple, and the levels that I have here are the 318s, below that the 312s, the 308s, and the 304s area, also then 295s. Above the 318s, we're watching the 328s, and then we're off to the races if we happen to break out on Apple. Microsoft is interesting, because when you saw so many tech names making just these all-time highs, Microsoft kind of went nowhere, and it's kind of still hanging in this same area. And so what you want to see on Microsoft, if you're bearish, and let me make this super clear, you want to see bullish advancement above these 180s, right? You want the 185 to break, and then you want to see bullish advancement above the 187s and a squeeze through the 191s. You want increasing volume and strength. If you're bearish, you kind of want the 176s to go away, and for us to sell down into the 160s, maybe the 163 area. So to the upside, we have 185, then 191. To the downside, 182, 176, 174, then 168. So we'll see how Microsoft shakes out, but those are levels to watch. And if you're wondering how I play these lines, a drop into the 182s and we find buyers, I get long. And if we drop hard through levels, I'm just looking for a place based on candle structure and also pivots and the levels that I draw in, a place where I think that the buyers may step in. And depending on the ticker, sometimes I may jump the gun and I might average a bit. And other times I wait to make sure that the buyers do step in, and I take it from that point where I enter into, for example, on this pullback here, if you're intraday, you can sort of see the setup a little bit better on the reversals, and you ride it right back into the one of your lines. So if it pulls back and down to here, you get in, you ride it right into here, you're out. And if you wait for it to pull through here, you ride it right into here and you're out. And up here, you sell. This, I keep saying up here, these 183s you sell, and then you try to ride it back into the 182s. And that's how I play my lines point to point. Checking, you know, a few other indicators to make sure that we're still bullish or if we're still bearish, and I try to follow the trend. McDonald's also interesting as it pushes up near this little channel, this 191 to 196. We don't see any bullish advancement above this same area that we tested. And this was in April into the beginning. Yeah, just April here. And couldn't go anywhere, sold. We're back here again. And it looks very similar. We couldn't get any bullish advancement up through the 191s. And we're pulling back. We'll see if the selling pushes us down similarly to the 178s and the 171s if the buyers step back in. And then if that does happen, this could in and of itself, just this block here, turn into a channel, an area where, you know, above the 190s, the lower 190s, the buyers just aren't interested and the sellers take control. And below the 171 area, the sellers are no longer interested and the buyers take control and pushes back up. So we'll see if this turns into one of those or if they can find a way to get us up into the 191s if we get a squeeze to the 196s. So this is interesting on McDonald's. So to the downside, the 178s, the 171s, and if we break this, the 161s, the upside, the 187s, 191s, if we can get into this channel, maybe test the 196s, give a rise there, potentially the 201s. But as of now, those the 190, almost the 190 whole dollar has been holding up as a strong supply area. ZM, and we mentioned earlier when we were taking a peek at Amazon, was there a rotation out of those tickers that benefited from the stay-at-home orders? And ZM could care less about that. Look at this push. So if you're watching this, right, anything above the 174s, we saw weakness right here. Look at this. Pull back here. Pull back here. Pull back here, pull back here. So if you saw this push up through 174, it would, from a technical standpoint, if you don't see strong news supporting this push, be logical to get short and have your stop be, do we see bullish advancement and a push up above these all-time highs? That's logical. Did I take this trade? I didn't. Someone like me, it just depends on the ticker. And on a ticker like ZM, I would probably, if I was watching this at the time, I would not jump in here. I would wait for the pullback and then fade it off of the 174s, 175s, and fade it off of that rather than trying to get the best price on the push through. And when you try to get the best price on the push through, unless you're really, really dialed in on a lower time frame chart and you're kind of scalping, what you get is this bullish continuation. So we'll see how this shakes out. But this is a good push on ZM. And if you're bullish and if you're long, hopefully it keeps running for you. If you're bearish, hopefully you've got a plan for the risk. And you're managing that bad boy very well. So if we do pull back, watch the 174-ish area. And if the buyers step in, they could pop us and run us to the top. And below that, the 164s. We'll see how that shakes out. But ZM looks crazy strong. If I just look at this chart, look at that push. ABBV. So what's interesting about ABBV is that is almost in what we would, you know, consider a channel. If I see multiple, I'll say reversals and the holding of specific levels over a period of time, like this isn't a huge period of time, but when we pull down to the 88.70s, buyers step in. When we push through the 92.90s, sellers step in. And so this is interesting. We'll see if this holds up or if this area is popped. If we pop the 92.90s, watch the 94.68s, then the 98.32s, above that, the 101.25s. If we drop the 88.70s, we're going to keep an eye on the 84.38s, then the 81.66s on ABBV. Next up is REGN. And we're mentioning on REGN that we were in a channel. And for quite some time, that channel did hold up. We couldn't get any bullish advancements above the 569-ish area. And we finally did get that. Look at this explosion, this bullish movement to the upside. So if you're a trader of REGN, we're testing all-time highs. One of the things to note with REGN is that the last time it pushed up into the 600s, it did not stay there for long and it sold off. So keep an eye on this to see if we see bullish advancements in the 600s. If we do, that'll be a different pattern and characteristic than what we've seen in the past. So REGN is interesting. Definitely keep an eye on her to see if it can continue to gain strength and momentum and volume, and if we can continue to push to the upside. The last time, just note that we pushed up in this area, it did not hold. So we'll see. But if you're in year long and you're following news, there's no reason not to expect this to continue to go up. So just keep an eye on this to see if it holds these 611s, it holds these 600s, and the buyers continue to be excited and push us to the upside. And if it repeats the previous pattern, then the sellers will sell this bad boy off and the buyers will step out of the way. And we'll see a nice fade all the way back down through the 570s and maybe even lower. So we'll see which way it goes. But at these levels, REGN definitely is interesting. And I'm going to probably set some alerts for this to get some good movement on this intraday. A note, the options for REGN are spready and they're very funny about their fills. So if you ever jump into this ticker, you want to make sure that you're riding the trend. Like whatever direction it's going, that you it's going to go in your direction 5 or more points for you to be able to get out of your position. So that's just my experience with it, that if you're in options and it's moving in your direction, you want it to go about 5 points or more in your direction to be able to get that feel where you'd like it to be. Next up is Dollar Tree. And Dollar Tree, we mentioned in a few videos, if you remember, this is the area that we mentioned, the 86-ish 70s to 89-40s. This area is the channel or the zone where things happen. They had earnings. They ripped through that. This candle back tested this area. Buyer stepped in, drove us to the upside. Now we're going sideways. So what we want to watch going into next week on Dollar Tree after this push on earnings, we want to keep our eye on will we hold this level? Is this consolidation? And will we run into the 101.90s? Or will this be faded? So I'll be watching Dollar Tree next week and be scalping and playing intraday. Once this decision is made on will the buyers hop in and continue to squeeze this to the upside, or is this nice pop that's cute and the sellers take control and sell us back, you know, sell us off to the downside? From these 98s, watch 97.70s, 94.60s, 91.47s, then back into this little zone here. The channel is pretty strong. This 89.40s and 86.70s to the upside, 101.95, 106.39, 111.08, 115.41. We'll see which direction we choose, and I'll probably be on this bad boy intraday. Definitely like Dollar Tree. Intel, interesting. What we see here is rejection, right? Almost similar to what we were seeing down here. So maybe we just reach another segment or another floor here that we're playing with where we see a push into the 6370s. We didn't see any bullish advancement above that this week, and a pullback near the channel that we were stuck in for, you know, a short period of time has not led to continued selling, right? So if we hold above the 6090s and stay below the 6370s, we may be in this channel just riding, going sideways. So would I say short this? Yeah, you could technically get short this at the 6370s with a tight stop, but you could also just wait to see if we break and hold that, if you're more bullish on the market and you think that we're going to run. So the 6090s and the 6370s are the areas to watch for break and holds, or if they hold up as far as a channel or becoming a mini channel, then we'd sell and remain in that area for a little, you know, period of time. So we'll see how that works out on Intel. And next up is Goldman Sachs. This was something that I did get a nice play on. So what we watched was when we pushed up into the 189s, and we've mentioned this in our previous videos, this channel we've shown you. And what we saw was a push through the top of the channel. And for me, I don't always do this. A lot of times wait for confirmation. I definitely got short quite a few contracts on this push up through here, out about a month. And this nice pullback through was a wonderful play. And definitely love it. So what we're watching for going forward is, will we sell back through the bottom of the channel, or will the buyers hold us inside this channel? So to the downside, we have the 189.50s, 177.90s, 171.30s, 166.40s. Above this, we have the 207s, the 214.90s, the 226s. We'll see how this next week goes on Goldman Sachs, but this push here and this run and this gap up to me was just unsustainable on Goldman Sachs, because I didn't see any information, regardless of if we're opening up or not opening up, any information that would be strongly beneficial to Goldman Sachs, not from anything that I saw. So on a push into an area that I saw as potential supply, I was short. And the way that I played this was stay long, like, you know, get short here on the push up into the 207s, roughly this area. And I actually got short around the 204.50s, 205. So I did jump the gun a little bit. And then once we break the 207.70s, the top of this area, get long against my position and scalp that intraday while swinging the monthly puts here. So let's check out the SPY. Okay, so this was a channel we were in for quite some time, and we're now above that. We did gap above that. How do you get through supply? You gap through it. And we'll see if we see advancement above the 307s next week. To the upside, we have the 315s, the 320s, then the 328s. To the downside, we have the 302s, the 294s, and the 286s right back in the channel. So we'll see how this plays out next week. I will be watching. If we gap above or I see bullish advancement above the 307s, I will be expecting the 315s. So we'll see how the week goes. If you enjoyed this video, tap the like button, and please also subscribe to our channel, Power of Pivots, on YouTube, where you can look forward to not just receiving more content from me, but also content from Elisa as she shows you how she utilizes her power of pivot script to find great entries and exits, not just intraday, but on swing plays, on futures, and on, you know, penny stocks. She kind of gets into everything. Thank you so much for your time. Stay safe and have a wonderful week of trading.